Lama, the nature of art, and the notion of the relic. The ubiquitous nature of the image of the Dalai Lama in Tibetan Buddhist circles reminds one of the importance of the image in those communities. These images, Buddhas, Bodhisattvas, and incarnations of the two, such as the Dalai Lama, can be categorized as Nideshika, or for our purposes, tertiary relics. Unlike sarira, which are bodily, or peribodhika, which are secondary relics, the notion of an image of relic is much more abstract. The use of the Dalai Lama's image for practitioners certainly encompasses the connections to the Buddha inherent in any relic. However, the current Dalai Lama's image provokes other thoughts as well, specifically the political and social notions for which the Dalai Lama has become known on the international level. In this paper, I address the current images of the 14th Dalai Lama, Tenzin Gyatso, and compare these images to the traditional Udeshika relic imagery of the current and previous Dalai Lamas. I explore how these images have or have not changed, asking the following questions. How has the Dalai Lama's international political role influenced the use of his image? How have modern artists utilized the Dalai Lama's image, and for what audience? Would these contemporary photographs and paintings be considered relics? By considering the previous questions, I intend to convey the importance of the role of the Udeshika relic, specifically the Dalai Lama's image, in contemporary Buddhist thinking, as well as to explore notions of the same Buddhist imagery outside of its traditional usage. Initially, images of the Dalai Lamas inherently promoted the reincarnation lineage. As the incarnation of the Buddha or Bodhisattva of compassion, Avalokiteshvara, the Dalai Lama position follows the historical kings of Buddhism in their role as leader and galvanizing figure in Tibet. As such, the images of the figures continue the visual importance of the Udeshika relic. Though not a physical remainder of a Buddha or teacher, the Udeshika relic serves as a reminder, as an image of a Buddha, a Bodhisattva, or Lama. Though not all images of these spiritual teachers are necessarily relics, the Dalai Lama images certainly encompass the notion of a reminder relic. John Strong proposes a clarified vision of what a relic entails, saying, quote, "I propose to view relics not as the embodiments of a transcendent or imminent or otherwise absent Buddha, nor just as functionally equivalent to the departed master, but as expressions and extensions of the Buddha's biographical process." In this way, the tertiary notion of the Udeshika relic, already an extension by nature of the more concrete concepts of sarira and paribodhika relics, works as a biographical extension. The images of the Dalai Lama certainly extend the Buddha's biographical process, and so our discussion begins with the earlier images. Michael Henn cites the earliest known representations of the Dalai Lama lineage to 1558, noting it as the year the title Dalai Lama was conferred upon the third leader, the first two being recognized posthumously, by Mongolian ruler Altan Khan. However, Henn is quick to note that this late image does not necessarily indicate an absence of depictions of the previous rulers. Regardless of date, there is no clear association of specific physiognomic traits to identify specific rulers. Rather, iconography is used to identify each image. For example, the first slide depicts the first four Dalai Lamas from 18th century Tonka paintings. Though this is not a series itself, it easily proves the difficulty in determining each leader as distinct from one another. The differences can be found in the iconography, though Henn lists at least four different iconographical versions for each one. So by that I mean each mudra would be different, attributes would be different, although I should mention that the fifth Dalai Lama is much more easily recognized. With the advent of photography, the generalization of images of the Dalai Lama would be replaced by the exact likeness of the man, and the portable and relatively inexpensive nature of photographs, at least compared to paintings, engendered a whole new form of tertiary relic. Before looking at individual images of the 13th and 14th Dalai Lamas in this new style, I turn to the modern images that promote the traditional lineage concept. Images of all 14 Dalai Lamas are displayed in the main temple at the Nordalinga in Dharamsala, India. Touch the screen. The first 12 figures are rendered in the traditional style, the figures only differentiated by iconographic changes. However, the images of the 13th and 14th Dalai Lamas utilize a combination of photorealism and traditional representation, and the 13th and 14th are on the lower left side. Though the final two images may seem odd in terms of stylistic choice, one finds the same combination of approach in the earlier Sami monastery mural in Tibet. Though it is quite difficult to find painted images of the 14th Dalai Lama that were not destroyed in Tibet, the third floor of the Samgyel Khan depicts all 14 of the spiritual masters. Again, the realistic manner of depicting the face is reserved for the final incarnation. A rare image of Tenzin Gyatso also remains at the Nordlinga in Lhasa. The Dalai Lama is surrounded by many other political figures in this interesting composition. Again, his specific facial features are easily recognized. This shift in imagery, the focus on realism over traditional methods, arrived with the 13th Dalai Lama, Lobsang Chultem Gyatso. The 13th Dalai Lama encountered political and social issues previously absent in Tibet. The impending arrival of modernity, along with the benefits and problems it brought to the region, Lobsang Chultem Gyatso became the first Dalai Lama intent on international relations. The leader accurately predicted the problems facing the Tibetan people today, and in some ways may have been trying to mediate the situation. Lobsang Chultem Gyatso was well aware of his changing international surroundings. Indeed, it was still a time of rampant colonialism. He strove to reaffirm a distinct Tibetan identity, one that would clearly distinguish his people from the neighboring Chinese. He was responsible for changes in Tibet's military, economy, and movement into the industrial realm. With the Chinese invasion and subsequent exile of the 13th Dalai Lama in 1910, foreshadowing the more permanent invasion almost 50 years later, the leader posed for several photographs in India by the British political officer Charles Bell. With this photograph, the 13th Dalai Lama and Charles Bell began the overhaul of the traditional Tibetan aversion to realism and imagery. As Claire Harris discusses in her article regarding Tibetans and photographs, Tibetans had previously used photographic representations during the bardo ceremonies, that is, as an indicator that the incarnation was ready to move to the next body. Harris confirms the extreme concern felt by Tibetans when, in 1933, the 13th Dalai Lama asked for his photograph to be taken. The previous images were photographed in India. In that case, the concern seemed warranted as the spiritual leader died shortly afterward. In any case, photographs of the leader soon spread to many practitioners. Bell gave several copies of his photographs to the 13th Dalai Lama, who, before his death, distributed them to monasteries and lay people. It is interesting to connect the concept of photographic proliferation to that of the relic. In his research on the subject of Buddha relics, John Strong notes the instances reported where the relic itself multiplied into several other relics. One can imagine this idea transmuted into one negative image, producing thousands of reprints. Strong quotes another scholar as saying that the practice of this proliferation of relics was so great, there was a, quote, hemorrhage of the sacred, end quote. This tradition of relic proliferation, dating back to the first division of the Buddha's relics and the 84,000 relics by Ashoka, continues in the modern era through the use of photographs. Specifically, the image of the Dalai Lama has become a Judaeshika relic easily obtained for personal veneration. As for the initial photographs of the 13th Dalai Lama, Bell noticed the impact of the images, stating, quote, they all used the photograph instead of an image, rendering to it the worship that they gave to the images of the Buddhas and the deities, end quote. Certainly, the transition was seen today in modern Tibetan Buddhist altars, where the central image is that of the Dalai Lama's photograph. Hence, it suggests that the importance of the photograph was so great it may have led to a decline in painted imagery, stating, so far, not a single tanka of the 13th Dalai Lama. No. Historically, artistic interpretation of Buddha imagery was quite limited. The figures generally conformed to very specific guidelines and grid lines. The consecration ceremonies likewise followed traditional procedures, ensuring the pure nature of the image as relic. With the advent of photography, the image of the Dalai Lama no longer conforms to these strict guidelines. Rather than viewing these modern photographs as lesser images or false relics, it appears, as mentioned with the image of the 13th Dalai Lama, that practitioners have embraced the availability images. Their authenticity in terms of the traditional representational guidelines is far from the mind of the practitioner. Rather, the man in the photo is the reminder. He is the Buddha himself. There is no need for guidelines, grid lines, and consecration. And considering the difficulty in obtaining images of the 14th Dalai Lama as a Tibetan in Tibet, it seems this relaxation of rules is warranted. In another paper, I discuss the political, social, and spiritual ramifications of the 1996 ban on the image of the 14th Dalai Lama in Tibet. I conclude that the Chinese government was unsuccessful in its attempt at removing a politically unifying agent, largely because the role of the Dalai Lama extends far beyond politics. First and foremost, the image of Tenzin Gyatso is a spiritual icon for the practitioners. Of course, there are more complexities involved, and the Tibetans unifying under his image are certainly aware of the political statement being made. However, the audience of the image of the Dalai Lama within Tibet is quite different from that outside of the restricted region. In Tibetan exiled communities, the political nature equally accompanies the relic quality of the image. For Western audiences, the religious nature may not be recognized at all. These audiences may be viewing the leader as a symbol of peace. Artists have appropriated Tenzin Gyatso's photographs and image for a variety of reasons: to promote peace, to juxtapose the man with the Buddha, or to document the leader's life. What follows is my interpretation of these images and how they relate to the initial spiritual role of the Dalai Lama's image. In 2004, the Committee of 100 for Tibet, working with the Dalai Lama Foundation, began collecting images for an exhibit that would encompass many facets of the current Dalai Lama's life. The resulting display included more direct portraiture alongside abstract visions of the Dalai Lama's quest for peace. When I visited the show at the New York Tibet House in 2007, the few pieces chosen exemplified the latter, leaving the casual viewer to make the connection between artistic representation and greater vision. Curator Randy Jane Rosenberg explains the greater exhibition's resulting imagery. Quote, "The themes that emerged became the organizing principle of the show. The exhibition can be seen as a spiral, beginning with the more concrete concepts about the Dalai Lama, his appearance, beliefs, religion, and homeland. The show then circles outward to include increasingly more abstract and universal themes, the ideals of human rights, peace and compassion, people in exile, and exploration of belief systems, paths of transformation, universal responsibility, globalization, and ideas of temporality and permanence. For the purposes of this paper, I've chosen to use only those images that more directly reference the current Dalai Lama in terms of physicality, though further exploration of the other images would certainly produce an interesting study." Unlike the artists of the previous Dalai Lamas, the creators of the images for the exhibition seem to be relaying a message of peace rather than a reminder. The exhibition was indeed titled The Missing Piece, Artist and the Dalai Lama. The title itself gives way to the accomplishments of Tenzin Gyatso, namely his Nobel Peace Prize and recent Congressional Gold Medal, both testaments to the leader's international quest for human rights and peaceful understanding between cultures. What is absent is the traditional notion of reverence to the relic. This is simply due to a different audience. Tibetan Buddhist devotees visiting the exhibition would undoubtedly view the images with the same reverence they would a more traditional Dalai Lama image. I'll explore these images, keeping both the nature of art and the notion of the relic in mind. I begin with Richard Avedon's image of Tenzin Gyatso amongst other monks. In one way, Avedon is reminding the viewer that the Dalai Lama is, in his own words, only one monk. However, the focus of the image clearly goes to the presence near the center of the photograph. The photographer has captured several aspects of the Dalai Lama's position in the world, doing so in a very modern context. The audience for the image will undoubtedly pause in admiration for the man pictured, but will not venerate the image as a relic. A devotee, however, would venerate this image. This portrait would be no different to a devotee than the images initially created as reminder relics. The image, however, commands other layers of meaning. Political and social connotations come to mind for the gallery viewer. The image easily connotes all of the positive aspects that have served to unite the international community, as well as the exile community, under the leadership and guidance of one man. Similar in construction to the Avedon image is the portrait of the Dalai Lama by Chuck Close. Those familiar with Close's portraits will recognize the style of the image, the subject's head filling the space, each detail captured perfectly with pristine color. As cited with the image in the exhibition catalog, Close demonstrates that, quote, "a very traditional genre, portraiture, could be resurrected to become a challenging form of contemporary expression," end quote. Truly, this image captures the beneficent qualities of the man. This is certainly not the splittist and agitator the Chinese government constantly degrades. As a work of art, Close follows his successful line of images that were created in much the same style. The viewer is brought to a new level of intimacy with the old tradition of portraiture. It is an intense image, a wonderful work of modern art. Again, for the devotee, it is a reminder of relic, an image of Avalokiteshvara to be venerated. Artist Guy Buffet brings a lighthearted quality to the subject matter in His Holiness and the Bee, how a little annoyance can bring great joy. The loose nature of the brushstrokes reiterates the easygoing attitude of the subject. Indeed, the Dalai Lama is shown handling an annoyance, the bee, with her playful quality. As the title suggests, the viewer follows the story from the onset of the annoyance to the ultimate joyful image of the Dalai Lama holding a lotus flower. Much can be read into this image, perhaps the understated annoyance of the incursion of China and the Dalai Lama's peaceful approach to handling the situation. The viewer is encouraged to find levels of meaning in this image. Again, the conflation of political and social meanings will certainly appeal to the audience viewing the work as modern art, though the Tibetan Buddhist practitioner would still view this image as a reminder relic. Finally, I turn to a quite interesting work from the Missing Piece exhibition. In artist Celestiano's work, Reincarnation, the viewer first encounters an overwhelming space filled with red. Naturally, the political nature of the image, that is, Red China, comes to mind. The viewer then notices the young child staring intensely at the audience. The gaze of the child is penetrating, almost disturbing. It is only when we connect the title of reincarnation to the image that we truly begin to recognize the significance of the work. Here is a portrait of a Buddha yet to come. One might think of Maitreya, the future Buddha, in his imagery. One might think of the notion of reincarnation and this portrait as a future image of Tenzin Gyatso. But more likely than not, one will connect the red coloring of the image to the dominance of China and the subsequent confusion that will ensue should China choose the next Dalai Lama. The words behind the child's head read Kechepe Yangsi, with the second word being obscured. The Kie indicates rebirth, and if the second word is She, it is the active idea of taking rebirth. The Yangsi translates as reincarnation and is linked with the genitive case to the obscured word. The artist is undoubtedly referencing the obscure future of the institution of the Dalai Lama. The ambiguity of the child's sex adds to the pensive nature of the painting. Could the next incarnation of the Dalai Lama be a girl? This image is especially interesting in the context of the relic. Would a practitioner find this image, a portrait of a yet unborn person, to be an Udeshika relic? It may be that there is no answer to this question. As the artist describes in his supplementary written piece, he did not receive any concrete answers to the questions he asked of Lamas, monks, and lay practitioners. Quote, at the beginning, I was dissatisfied and disoriented. Little by little, I realized that they were not giving me closed answers. They were opening the door in order for me to travel my own way across this subject. My intention is not to give you an instruction manual on how to interpret the artwork. Its theme is reincarnation and compassion, and I intend to open the door not to a closed room, but to an open field, end quote. And so, as the author suggests, the painting forever remains open to interpretation, perhaps as the epitomizing image of the Dalai Lama's portrait as art and relic. In 2001, photographer Manuel Bauer was given permission to travel with the Dalai Lama, photographing his daily life for preservation in both an online archive and print form. In the introduction to the website, Bauer describes his reason for the project. Quote, the archive aims to preserve a comprehensive body of photographic work of the 14th Dalai Lama with the goal of strengthening and building the identity of the Tibetan people, as well as of men around the world and of future generations, end quote. This clearly ambitious project uses only photography in its method of message conveyance. When considering the relatively new medium of photography and its impact on Buddhist art, one is reminded of the early artists of the historical Buddha. They reportedly created the images of the teacher from looking at his reflection in a pool of water, thus avoiding the dangerous nature of direct divine eye contact. By using the photographic lens as the reflective pool, the artist again avoids the direct representation. I have chosen images from Manuel Bauer's work that emphasize several aspects of the Dalai Lama's life. One is reminded of the biographical scenes of the Buddha when looking at these photographs depicting the Dalai Lama. Some reiterate the spiritual and peaceful qualities of the man. Others provide glimpses into the more human nature of Tenzin Gyatso, images that do not necessarily invoke the concept of relic, though they may indeed still be ones. These photographs certainly blur the lines between modern artistic representation and tertiary relic veneration. The first group of images to be discussed herein are easily recognized as those of a great spiritual leader. The concept of Udeshika relic easily applies, as the importance of the Buddha's leader is quite clearly depicted. In this first photograph, the Dalai Lama is photographed at an instructional session at Tukten Dorje Dak Monastery in Kasumti in Himachal Pradesh. Though his posture is a bit relaxed, he wears the traditional clothing and is accompanied by the traditional materials of a Tibetan Buddhist leader. Likewise, the image of the Dalai Lama at Jonang Monastery in Sanjali in Himachal Pradesh, he also easily fits one preconceived notions of what a spiritual master looks like. This type of portrait would be found on many Tibetan Buddhist altars, again, a clear indication of an Udeshika relic. Other Bauer images shift our perceptions by changing the Dalai Lama's environment. In the photograph of Tenzin Gyatso at the Sheraton in Zagreb, Croatia, the image depicts the normative posture of meditation, though the leader is now removed from a more traditional setting. This juxtaposition is intentional and encourages the viewer to think about the Dalai Lama's human nature. This human nature is further exposed in another image from the same Sheraton hotel stay, where we see the Dalai Lama drinking casually, perhaps watching television. Undoubtedly, some viewers are initially uncomfortable with this image. Practitioners may feel that reverence to the leader is not being adequately portrayed. Non-practitioner viewers, with visions of the Nobel Peace Prize in mind, may feel the same. However, the Dalai Lama has always described himself as a monk first, and the human nature of the man is more evident in this image than is his Buddhist status. In conclusion, I briefly turned to images I recently photographed and have not yet explored in depth. The first are from the Tibetan exile community in Dharamsala, India, during the daily protests of the Chinese Olympic Games. About half of these protests utilized images of the Dalai Lama. This is quite interesting when one places this in a political context. The The chants for a free Tibet do not echo the Dalai Lama's own stated desire for a true Tibetan autonomy under Chinese rule rather than independence. And yet the image is quite prominent, leading the way during several of the protests. And finally, upon arrival at Denver International Airport, the familiar face of Tenzin Gyatso greets the traveler. Here, his image is used to promote a peace organization rather than to suggest a political stance. The image reaffirms a universal message of peace that many rightly associate with the man, though the notion of the relic here is certainly challenged. There are many contexts in which the image of Tenzin Gyatso, the 14th Dalai Lama, can be viewed. I have here briefly explored the notion of the relic and the image's use in artistic contexts. I hope to continue this exploration with more recent images detailing a more social and political context, and ultimately define a multivalent approach to viewing images of the 14th Dalai Lama.